I believe you can fly.
And life was nothing but
you can soar. You can expand your consciousness. You can go to the next level of reality.
Now I know the meaning of true love.
That's R. Kelly right here in Chicago, Illinois. The everlasting arms. If you visualize it, imagine it, then you can activate it. You can do it. You can become it. If you just believe it, there's nothing to it.
I believe you can fly.
I like this. Touch the sky, the higher reaches and regions of consciousness. Think about it. Then spread your wings and go to the next level. Fly away. Strength will be renewed like an eagle's.
Open door.
I believe you can fly. We can fly. I believe we can fly. I love that so much. Isn't that great? That's good old R. Kelly. He used to live in one of the buildings we lived in here for a while. I saw him one time and in the workout room, but we didn't talk. But he's a great songwriter and a great singer. So hello, everybody, and welcome to Streaming Consciousness. I'm Carlton Pearson, your friend and fellow sojourner in expanded consciousness and radically inclusive love. You are on your way to greater personal enlightenment, and I want to meet you there, and I plan to meet you there in consciousness. And consciousness simply means awareness, knowledge or perception of a reality, a situation, a fact or a function, self-awareness, self-actualization, terms I like to use a lot, is the most important objective and destination of your soul, of your being in this earthly realm, that you would actualize, become actually, factually, I always like to say functionally and punctually you, not impersonating, not an imposter. Who is that person that only shows up every now and then? We don't often give ourselves permission to be who we really are. We don't interact or interface with ourselves. We always play around with the imposter, the impersonator, the one that's trying to gain somebody's approval or affirmation. But we need to push that aside. That's what I'm doing. It took me over 50 years to get to the place where I could be free enough. So if you sense there must be more, then there is more. And a lot of people are saying, there's got to be more to this. I was saying that around age 50. There's got to be more. Successful in ministry, life, family, everything was going great. Money in the bank, thousands of people listening, traffic jams on Sunday, great conferences many of you may have heard of, written books, recorded albums, received awards for them. But then I kept saying, there's got to be more fulfillment, more self-actualization. The people like me, but I didn't like me yet. I didn't know me because I didn't give myself permission to explore me. You won't know you till you explore you. So I began to do that. And when I did, I found aspects of courage, boldness, curiosity, reality that I had not known was even in existence. And that's why I encourage people all the time to keep evolving, keep extending and expanding yourself, getting to know yourself. That is your infinite being. It doesn't end. And you don't want to be so definite. You want to be infinite. Some people want to be definite. That definite put means you put an end to it. El fin, the word is in Spanish, the end. Definition puts the limitations. Anybody who tries to define you is trying to put limits on you. So don't look for definition. Look for infinity. Be your infinite self rather than your definite self. If you want to be definite about anything, be definite about it being infinite. Your ongoing, evolving, unending, immutable, immeasurable, immortal, immediate self, the now you, which is always evolving. Well, I hope that you're planning to join me around another, maybe 100 other spiritual and business leaders here in Chicago for the Leadership Summit. We're calling it the Metacostal Network Leadership Summit. It'll be October 14th through the 16th. It'll start on Monday night and end at noon on Wednesday. We're looking at probably the Congress Hotel here in Chicago, but we'll give you the fuller details. We're closing on that deal soon. We'll have a little quaint, intimate time together right across the street from Millennium Park, Buckingham Fountains. Beautiful time of year here in Chicago. Fall leaves will be changing and you'll enjoy good food. And you can stay at that hotel or any hotel of your liking. But write the dates down now, October 14th through 16th, Monday through Wednesday seem to be the best days that we can do that. And it's going to be real informative. I don't bring any dress clothes, just casual jeans, jogging off, whatever you want to wear. And we'll sit and talk and interact, not a big name speakers. And we're going to ask questions and answer questions and then question answers about a number of things when it comes to expanding the consciousness and inclusiveness, radical inclusion, and extending the self and soul and getting to meet other people of similar journeys. And share. I want to hear your stories, not just speak all the time, but hear your stories and hear your journey and share and exchange names and addresses and, get to know one another. There's a small group, but a growing group of people who are, I call it Metacostal. Many are coming out of Pentecost, out of my background in Pentecost, but they want to, they're looking and leaning toward what I call expanded consciousness, new thought, new ways of being, new ways of seeing, new ways of perceiving. And we're giving a list of books and I'm also asking, we're putting on the first ever Holy Land Inclusive Peace Tour the next year, 2014, that same month in October, towards the middle of the month, we're going to be going to the Holy Land. I've made several trips over there, but never one like the one I'm about to make. In fact, our tour guide, Ronnie Wexler, is an advisor to the Prime Minister. He is in Israel right now with the Prime Minister and charting out the course for us. We're going to meet with Jews, Muslims, Christians, Druids. We're going to go up to Haifa, to the headquarters, the world headquarters of the Baha'i faith, which is basically an inclusive faith. And they have a temple right here in Chicago. Beautiful. I've been studying that since I was in high school. Fascinated with it, but it really didn't have permission to really delve into it in great depth because of the way I was raised. But anyway, I'm free now. You're free. And we're going to go to the Holy Land and have a great panel every night. We'll go across the Sea of Galilee. I'll baptize anybody who wants to in the Jordan just for nostalgic reasons. And we'll eat St. Peter's fish. We'll have a lot of fun. We'll eat some wonderful Jewish cuisine and Islamic food. And it's just going to be an overall life-changing experience for you. I'm also inviting as many of you who will to become Charter Member Inclusion Peace Agents and support us financially every month at any amount. We're trying to raise about $250,000 now to extend everything, expand everything, different cameras, to do panels, to do radio, to add one or two other staff people, and to begin to travel some and put on short 2 or 3 day conferences like in a hotel and have interaction with people. And we're planning to do something in South Africa in not too distant future. We want to have tours and cruises and, lay back, learn, love, light, leisure. And go through not only inspiration and information, but transformation, which is what I want to talk to you about tonight. And my theme, which I posted today, sort of late in the day, but this is the kind of the theme that I'm at right now. You are not in trouble. You are in transition. Hear me when I tell you, you're not in trouble. I know what that's like. I know the trauma, the drama. I want to talk about the power of transition, the power of imagination, and the power of transformation. Really, the privilege of transition, the privilege of images, imagining, mapping in your mind, and the privilege of transformation. Transition is the process of or period of changing from one state or condition to another, moving from one place or one state of mind to another. Many people are going through that. You're restless. You feel a little awkward, a little uncomfortable. There's nothing wrong with you. You are not in trouble. You're just going through an evolution. You're going through transition. Eat first in your thinking. It's like going to the same restaurant you've gone for 30 years, ordering the same meals or few meals that you do, and they don't appeal to you anymore. They don't taste the same. There's nothing wrong with the food. It's just that your taste buds are changing. What you require, what you desire, what you're interested in changes. That's okay. Don't freak out over that. I was going through change 10 years before I spoke of it publicly. Before I told anybody about it, I would allude to those things, feel my way around to see where people's minds were, and most weren't ready. So for 10 years, I muddled through this and meditated and prayed, and I even fasted and sought God and sought myself and my soul. And it was like layers of old ways of thinking and being were being taken off of me. and I was becoming increasingly free, unencumbered, and I was losing my entrapments and actually going into transcendence. I would actually go into a trance. That's where we get the word transcendence. I would go into a trance and leave my body, leave my place. It's called ecstasy. Ek meaning out of status. Ecstasy. You out of your standing, where you were thinking, you move to another way of being. Very powerful. Many millions of people are going through it right now. They don't know what to say about it, as I didn't. And there was nobody guiding me at that time. This was way before I had met the Michael Beckwiths, and there was no Super Soul Sunday and Oprah. I had Pentecost. I was speaking in tongues and rejoicing and worshiping God and all the things that Pentecostal people do. And I had enjoyed a certain level of transcendence, but I hadn't evolved to where I was actualizing myself. I wasn't changing the formula, transforming and to change the form and the formula. My imagination. Imagination is the faculty or action of forming new ideas, images, or concepts of external objects not present to the senses. It's something inward. It's the mental imaging of an idea or an ideology. An idea is just an opinion or a belief. Opinion, ops is the Greek word for I, a view of things, a perception. Ideology is a system of ideas and ideals, especially ones that form the basis of your personal policies, your personal opinions. Imagination is some of the most pregnant and powerful energy there is. Imagination is some of the most pregnant and powerful energy in existence. And you do imagine yourself not just wealthier and healthier and happier, but more fulfilled and filled full of ideas, of concepts, of self-worth and self-wealth. Reclaiming and recovering, reconnecting and recollecting with the forgotten self. Getting past spiritual amnesia to the contract and covenant you entered pre-incarnately, before you got to this planet or plane of consciousness. I believe that we all agreed to come here. Most of us forget it, and in that amnesia or forgetfulness, we panic, and we say, oh, I didn't sign up for this. You actually did sign up, in fact, created the reality that you're experiencing right now. When I say these kinds of things, I'm basically giving you your power back. Like the song said, I believe you can fly, you can soar, you can come to higher awareness, elevated thoughts. The power of transition, imagination, and transformation. What is transformation? It is a metamorphosis during your life's cycle. They always happen. Sometimes we block them. Sometimes we're not aware of them. Sometimes we resist them or even resent them. We get too comfortable in the comfort zone, in the areas of familiarity, and we don't evolve. But transformation is this kind of a metamorphosis. You change the form. Morphe means form. During your life cycle, it is a thorough, or sometimes it's a very dramatic change from appearance. Appearance is not just physical. In fact, it is a little more than physicality. It's a lot more than physicality. Appearance is where we get the term apparentness. What is apparent? What is clearly visible or understood? What is obvious about you? That's what is apparent. But it also means to seem real or true. Apparentness does. But not necessarily to be so. There's a lot of things about you and me and us and the world that are illusions. They seem to be real and true, but they are not. Perception is the ultimate reality, but not necessarily the ultimate truth. I've been saying that for years. Many years, over 20 years. Perception, what you perceive, is your ultimate reality, but it's not necessarily the ultimate truth or accurate, the correct way. Accurate way of being or thinking or realizing. Transformation is the secret and sacred self coming to life and coming to light or coming to surface. The real you, the authentic or authorized you. Authentic comes from the word author, the originator, the sponsoring idea that spawned your presence in the earth. That's deeper than your dad's seed fertilizing your mother's egg. That's the physical aspect, and it's scientific. But the spiritual part is the idea, the original idea of you. You are an original. You were born an original. You do not have to die a copy. There is an original essence, an authentic essence that is you. And that forms itself repeatedly, and it reforms and transforms constantly the forms and formulas of being. Very powerful. You're not something that's conceived in someone else's mind, but in your own mind. Who are you? Why are you? What do you plan to do with what you know about you? And what do you know about you? That's why I often ask, what do you believe and why do you believe it? And how do those beliefs add to or subtract from the quality of your life? What do you believe about you? Why do you believe that? Where do those beliefs come from? Are they true about you or just beliefs? What do you believe about you? Why do you believe that? And how do those beliefs about you add to or subtract from the quality of your life? Again, you are not in trouble, friend. I mean, there may be tension in your marriage. There may be tension on the job. Your money is funny. Things are disheveled. You feel it inwardly. It's like your skin crawls. But that's not the end. That means you're being moved into your next realm or way of being. You're not in trouble. You're in transition. Trouble is just means difficulty or problems, and everybody has them. The mal or misfunction of something. The malfunction or the misfunction of something, including the mind or in consciousness. Your mind can mal or misfunction because your thinking gets obscure. It's called insanity. Sanity, sanitation. Anything that's sanitized is purified and cleansed and, you know, decontaminated. When your mind or your thoughts are pure or clear, I should say, it's murky, muddy water, you can't see. You're in the water, you're in the spirit, but you can't see. It's not clear. And that's what trouble is. It's a perceived cause of worry or anxiety. You're feeling inconvenienced. You're feeling uncomfortable. You're feeling awkward. You're feeling abstract and spastic. And we all go through that when you are going through the change. I wish I could talk to the serpent and the serpent could explain to me what it feels when it sheds its skin every year. I wish I could communicate with a caterpillar and a butterfly as they go through the transition. I wish I could talk to the chick as it bursts out of the egg. Maybe they wish they could talk to me too, because they see that we go through things and experiences. Perhaps they know the earth, and instinctively they're one with Mother Earth in that natural, supernatural reality. We can all get there. It's spiritual. Trouble and trauma often work and walk together and lead to transition or become part of it. It's like birthing. When pain and primordial fluids are flowing, it can be messy and emotional and frightening in many cases. Birthing is not always that delicate and beautiful. We saw the queen, the princess, and Kate Middleton and the prince bring the little baby out, and it was all wrapped in the little swaddling clothes like we or both of ours were. But actually in the birthing suite, when there's grunting and weepings and pain and pushing and fluids and the amniotic fluids and then the afterbirth, it's not pretty. It's not even lovely. It's precious, but it's also pressurous. That's birthing. She's stretched out for 9 months. And Kate Middleton actually allowed people to see she still had a little stomach. I don't remember Gina having that much of a stomach after both our children were born. Some women carry that for a while. Others lose it in a matter of weeks. But she was proud of it because that's the pouch which the baby got here. But it's not always pretty. She dressed it. She made it look lovely. I remember us buying certain maternity clothes for Gina when she was carrying our children. Lovely outfits. Sometimes matching hats. She would go to church looking like a doll, like she stepped out of a magazine with these beautiful outfits. People were bringing us nice things, even for the children. But the birthing itself, not just the pregnancy, the birthing itself, when the baby actually comes out, many people are being birthed. This is a movement that's being birthed. This is a spiritual renaissance, an essence that's coming forth out of the earth. And it may seem a little awkward, a little sloppy, if you will. But it is coming nonetheless. It's not going to be aborted. It's not going to be miscarried. It's not going to be premature. going to be born right on schedule, right on time, right on target. Many people resist birthing because they're intimidated by the drama and the trauma and the threat of injury. You feel like you're going to injure something, or you actually feel wounded in when you're birthing something. That could be a business, could be a ministry, could be a career. You're starting something. People make commitments and they don't show up, and the money acts weird, and you think you have a building, then it shifts and changes, and you feel injured, you feel attacked, you feel abused. Shh, please. The word wound, somebody's in the kitchen. The word wound is translated in Greek trauma. The word wound is the Greek word trauma. That's where we get it from. It refers to a blow or strike or hit or hurt or harm, to be injured or impaired, literally impeached. Impeached means to call into question the integrity or the validity of something. Have you ever impeached your own idea or felt impeached by an idea? Called into question your own integrity, your own validity of the dream, the service, the self, the purpose? Have you questioned who you are? That's very common. We all do at some point. Should I have done this? Is this the right decision? Am I headed in the right direction? Why does this feel strange? I've never been here before. Very often you'll hear in churches, when you visit new churches, and I worked with one here for about a year and a half as an interim senior minister, and I had to tell the staff, don't keep saying to me, we've never done it that way before, because that means I'm not sure I want to do it. Well, we've never done it that way before. We've never done it that way. Businesses, even relationships, well, we've never done it. Do something you've never done before. Well, you might say, well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Well, sometimes it is broke. It's limping. It's irrelevant, and you don't know it because it's not extending to the next level of expression or the next level of experience. You're going to the same thing, the same motions, the same ruts and routes and routines as always, and you're rubbed raw and dry. You wonder why it hurts, because there's been no anointing, no oil, no divine lubricant on it any longer, because the approval of it has lifted. The energy has gone someplace else. You got to move with the tide and the times and stay current in the flow of consciousness, the flow of evolution, the flow of spirituality. Stay current. Stay in the current, even if it seems a little tumultuous and it gets faster. I've been whitewater rafting. I did that in my college days down in Arkansas. And the water was cold, but it was a blast. It was exhilarating, almost frightening, almost scary. We'd get in that thing and just be flowing down the white caps, and sometimes we'd fall out, or somebody would fall out of the boat and or the raft, and we'd have to turn around, or they'd have to swim, and it was pretty risky. It was exhilarating, it was threatening, but it was a whole lot of fun. And I wanted to experience the exhilaration of movement. Sometimes you gotta give up a little bit of control and remain curious, live on the edge. I often say, I heard somebody say that one time, and I love it, if you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much space. If you're not living on the edge, take a risk. Push the envelope. So, are you, and I posted this today, are you feeling confused or confusion, confounded, or a sense of obscurity, poor vision, the inability to see clearly or see with clarity? If so, this is often a sign of transition, radical or otherwise. You're moving to another level. You're moving to the next level. You think about that. What does that mean? I can't see. It's like walking in the dark and you can't see around the corner, so you slow your pace down because you don't know what the twist was, like that train that many saw today in Paris or in overseas that was going too fast around the corner. It's going twice the normal speed. My wife just handed me a little note that said slow down. Sometimes I get animated and you get going in life and you're full of zeal and ideas, but you got to slow down and take the curves. Sometimes when you're going a straight path, you can kick the speed up. But when there are curves in the road, and especially if you don't know where they are, pace yourself. don't become too anxious or experience anxiety. Scripture actually says, be careful or anxious for nothing, nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Prayer, prosukamai, leaning forward, supplication to request or to desire and require with thanksgiving. Whenever I pray, I'm not begging. I always thank God that I have what I think I lack. You really lack nothing. But when you get to the place where you think you do, you start asking. When you request, you're acting like you don't already have it. So I'm learning even how to reword and redirect or reposture or reposition my prayer or my thought life. Because prayer is just a thought. Sometimes it's a nonverbal thought. It's just the energy of anticipation, the energy of imagination, as we alluded to earlier. So if you feel that you're in transition and you can't see, that's a good sign. Embrace the conflict, if you will. Embrace the sense of awkwardness. Don't try to fix it right now. You haven't been here before. You haven't been to this particular place. So love yourself through it. Don't criticize yourself through it. Don't over-pursue and over-press yourself. Just stay the course. Keep the pace. Perceiving transition accurately is as challenging as awakening in the morning and needing to readjust your eyes to the light of a new day. Nobody likes for somebody to come in the room in the middle of the night when the lights are on and just flip the bright light on. The first thing you'll say is, turn that light on. Oh my God, what do you need? What do you want? You're very irritated. Some people have overslept. And by the time they wake up, the sun is bright. Movement is out there. And they wake up and you wipe the sleep out of your eyes and you try to focus. Sometimes you're looking at the clock. You're trying to see the clock, especially the older you get. You're trying to focus in on the clock. I turn the TV on and watch the news. If I wake up at 7, sometimes I wake up lately between 3 and 5 in the morning. That's a time of meditation. I have to think. And sometimes just maybe 20 minutes or so before I can go back to sleep. And I'm just there still. Now, regardless of what time I go to sleep, I will wake up right around 7 o'clock. That's been the last 30 years. And I usually watch Good Morning America or the Today Show. I recapture and captivate what's happening in the world. And I start focusing my energy and purpose. When I see the news, it makes me feel more relevant to the planet. Some people hate the news because it seems all bad, but it really inspires me to pursue. That's why I ask so often for you to stand with us and what we're doing to make monthly or weekly gifts of any size, whether it's $5 each time we talk or 10 or 50 regularly. And, you know, just stay with us because we are trying to help correct or make things more accurate on the planet and less obscure and less obscene and less absurd. There is an accurate way of being, and it's for all of us. It's very powerful. It's very possible. I close most of my letters and emails with peace is possible. I believe in the possibility. When I say peace, I mean calm resolve, ultimate resolve. I don't mean that it's completely without conflict. You know, anything in motion, it's a law of physics. Anything in motion does cause friction. But friction comes only to give you traction for forward thrust. If it's too oily, it's too easy, you're not going anyplace. Your wheels are spinning. But when there's a little traction, a little friction, where the rubber meets the road, you start making forward thrust and headway. So embrace the traction or the friction, if you will, and make it your friend. Let it give you forward impulse. And thrust. It's right. All things, all the ingredients work together. They work in concert. So perceiving transition, again, accurately, is a challenge. So when it starts happening, don't just leap. Wait till you see what's happening and where you are. Then take that leap. And the leap won't be so startling. Transformation and imagination are the genesis of a new realm of possibilities. Transformation and imagination are the genesis, the beginnings, the genetics, the genes of a new realm of possibility. And there are always new realms of possibilities of things that can and will occur by your own creation. And remember, we're not just created beings. We are creative beings and creating, ing, beings. right now as we speak, you and I, whatever time you're viewing this, archivally or otherwise, you are creating, bodily you're creating, saliva, urine, blood, cells are repeating and replenishing themselves. You're constant, you are a ball of energy and life and creation, always. What my encouragement for you to do is become deliberate and intentional and more aware, not only that of that you are creating, but of what you are creating, and create it on purpose. Create it intent. Whatever you're experiencing right now in your life, you had something to do with creating it in consciousness, in your thought life, in the words you speak, in the way you think, in what you believe about you, and about your purpose and position and placement on this planet. You do fit here. You agreed to come here. You entered a covenant with creation or creator to come to this planet or plane net of consciousness to experience your divinity, express and expose it in the universe to all. And what happens when you do that? You remind other people of their divinities, which many people forget or are misconstrued, and they start acting out in another way. We encourage each other. We fascinate each other. We remind each other. So transformation is not external. It is internal, and it affects your interior being or your interior self. It relates primarily to consciousness, awareness, and then manifests later in your life in powerful human experiences. Imagination is visionary, it's visuals, and it involves perceptions and intentional expectations. Spectate, vision, view, perception, intentionally viewing it. Don't make it right, see it right, perceive it right, because what you see is what you get. Your imagination, thoughts are like images. And the images in your mind are like magnets. They literally pull you toward them. Whatever you imagine is like a magnet. It will pull you toward them. Thoughts are powerful. They are creative. Thoughts are inventive. So know what you're thinking and think on purpose and think with purpose. You're just beginning to realize maybe how incredibly powerful you are. Yes, you have the privilege of living, but you have the power of living and the power to live and make live or make alive. You can create. You can access. You can accentuate. You can enunciate yourself and your soul in the universe. People will feel your energy when you walk in a room. People will feel it in the texture of your voice. Do you know I have more people who recognize my voice than recognize my face? I had a guy stop me the other day. I was on my way to Las Vegas, and my daughter and I were going up there, and the gentleman in front of me in line, we were boarding the plane, turned around and said, "Your name is Carlton Pearson." No, he said, "You're a preacher, right?" I said, "Yes." "Carlton Pearson?" I said, "Yes." I said, "Do we know each other?" He said, "I heard you on This American Life about 5 years ago, and I recognized your voice." He heard me one time. Of course, that's an hour long, and they've repeated it. It first aired about, I don't know, maybe 6 or 7 years ago. I can't remember. But whenever he heard it, he remembered the texture and tone. I really believe he heard the intonation of my spirit in my voice. People heard that particular interview. It was an hour long interview. Normally, they give about 20-minute vignettes, but they did a whole hour long. It's called This American Life on NPR, National Public Radio. He heard the voice. Now, there's an energy. You know what he heard? He heard my destiny. He heard my transformation. He heard my inspiration. He heard the covenant, the sound of my covenant to come to this planet, the pre-existent reality that I came from to this plane. And I've been aware of that all my life, that there was something very real. Even before I understood what that meant, but I felt it as a child. I'm talking about elementary, grade school, primary school age, kindergarten. I remember it. I remember feeling a sense of significance all the way back to and before kindergarten. So I was born with it, as you are born with destiny. You're with a calling and a coding, but it involves transitioning and transformation and moving from one level of being to the next level of being and seeing and realizing and actualizing and forming and transforming. Very powerful. It's you. That is who you are. Albert Einstein said, imagination is more important than knowledge. For knowledge is limited to all we now know and understand, while imagination embraces the entire world and all there ever will be to know and understand. Shall I quote him again? Isn't that a powerful statement? Imagination is more important than knowledge. Now remember, this is a scientist, a genius. Science means knowing. Science, conscience, conscience. To know, to co-know. To know as others know, to know as you are known. But he says imagination is more important than knowledge or than science. For knowledge, science, is limited to all we now know and understand, while imagination embraces the entire world and all there ever will be to know and understand. He's talking about infinite experiences, infinite realizations. Infinite, ongoing, unending actualizations. He's talking about the God cell or the God being, maybe the God best, which is infinite. It's undefinable. It keeps going. Allow yourself to be pushed out of the box of familiarity, including all and any comfort zones that you may, any comfort zone, so that you may experience and express yourself on higher levels of awareness and personal power. Allow yourself to be pushed or pulled or drawn or led out of the box of familiarity. That's a challenge. That's part of the transition. You're not in trouble. You're in transition. You're being pushed out of the box from one comfort zone to broader comfort zones, but you'll never know it until you let go of it. You'll never know it till you let go of it. How about that? You got to make the next step. It takes a lot of courage to release the familiar and seemingly secure. I'm going to quote Alan Cohn. Love his quotations. It takes a lot of courage to release the familiar and seemingly secure, to embrace the new. I've had to do that. I still have to do that. I keep on doing it. I've been doing it now for the last 10 years. More graphically, more deliberately, more intentionally, more awareingly, almost more dramatically. So it takes a lot of courage to release the familiar and seemingly secure, to embrace the new. But there is no real security in what is no longer meaningful. There is no real security in what is no longer significant or relevant in your life. Look at the things around you that are irrelevant. It's like things you have in storage that you haven't seen or worn or used in 10 years or 5 or sometimes 2. And you haven't even missed it. You know where it is and you know kind of that it is, but you don't even know what it is anymore. It's in storage and you don't even need it. And you're paying monthly bills to keep it. Think about that. There is no real security in what is no longer relevant, no longer meaningful, no longer useful to you. It is, doesn't mean it's not useful to somebody. You might ought to give it away. There's a lot of things you might want to give it away, or some you may want to sell it. But it's no longer useful to you. It has no use to you. You have forgotten that you own it. There is more security, as I want to continue Alan Cohen's comment. Quote, there is more security in the adventurous and exciting, for in the movement, there is life. And in change, there is powerful. For in movement, there is life. And in change, there is power. Let me say it again because I love this statement. It takes a lot of courage to release the familiar and seemingly secure, to embrace the new. But there is no real security in what is no longer meaningful. There is more security in the adventurous and exciting. For in movement, momentum, there is life. And in change, there is power. So you must make the change manage the change, and ultimately master the change. You are not in trouble. You are in transition. This may be one of the most powerful junctions in your life. Don't resist it. Don't resent it. Don't protest it. Don't contest it. Don't even question it. Embrace it. Bring it close to you. Make it your friend and not your enemy. I love the scripture that says, be careful entertaining strangers, or neglect not, don't forget to entertain strangers. Heteros in Greek. The unfamiliar. The alien. Or the foreign. Something out of the norm. Or out of the niche. Don't neglect to entertain strangers. That's strange ideas, strange relationships, strange conversations, strange ideologies, something foreign to you, something outside the familiar. I'm not saying weird and wild. I'm just saying something with which you are less familiar with. You don't feel an immediate kinship to. You may be drawn to it, and you're going to explore and experiment, if you will, and even experience it. So I challenge you to take the deep leap of faith into the deeper waters of your unlimited possibilities and potential. Be careful. Don't forget to entertain strangers, for some have entertained angels or messengers or messages unaware. Every strange experience of your life has a message in it. And the more strange it is, the more profound the message can be. Take the leap of faith. Plunge into the deep. Jesus said, and is quoted to have said, launch out into the deep for a drought, a real catch. Put your fishing pole down, catching one fish at a time, and throw out a net or a network and pull in this conglomerate of diversities and new ideas and pluralistic cultures and ideologies, and sort through them and sort out of them and test them all, as scripture also says, and then hold to that which seems good. They're all good, but it doesn't always seem good to you. So test it all. Enjoy the new ages and stages of life, of thought, of abilities, and then further create upon them. Reach out and receive them. Remember, and make the necessary transition. There are necessary. Make the necessary transition and do it with passion. Do it with intention. Do it deliberately. Do it on purpose and do it with purpose. I know you will. I believe you will. And remember Marianne Williamson, her powerful words. I had the privilege of meeting and spent about 3 days with her in Tulsa for a special conference where she was speaking, and some friends of mine invited me down who were hosting her, and so I enjoyed some wonderful interaction with her. But here's a statement. I actually thought Nelson Mandela originated this statement because I heard it in his, I read it in his inaugural speech when he became president. But actually, he's quoting Marianne Williamson, who often is quoted by Oprah Winfrey. She's a brilliant thinker. But here's her, and many of you have already heard this. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, she says, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small doesn't serve the world. There's nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It's not just in some of us. It is in everyone. All of us. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. Isn't that powerful? Again, I was on the verge of breaking down. Embrace the power of transition, imagination, and transformation. You are amazing. there are miracles in life. You must achieve your own miracles. But first, it's got to start inside of me, in you, in we, in us. If you could see it, perception is the ultimate reality. Vision it. You can be what you see. You can have what you see and what you say. Believe it. Inch by inch, anything is a cinch. I believe you can fly. I love this. Touch the sky, the higher reaches of rhythms and regions of consciousness. Think about it. Then spread your wings. Fly away. I believe you can soar. I see me running through an open door. Do you see the door opening to you? Opening for you? Opening as you? Opening to you? Opening through you? You can fly. Carlton Pearson, thanks for listening to streaming consciousness. It doesn't stop. It just keeps flowing and flowing and flowing in you and as you, through you, to you. If you can see it, you can do it. That's a command. That's a declaration. Just believe it. There's nothing to it. Go ahead. Make that transition and you can fly. We will. Join as a charter inclusion consciousness peace agent. Let me hear from you tonight. Take your bank card. Join up. Let's make this movement go. We can soar like angels and eagles to the next level of awareness. We can run through that door. Oh my, that inspires me. I can believe you can fly. Say it, I can fly. I will fly. Spread those wings. Come on, make it to that next level. Spread the wings. Take the risk. Come on, walk along the edges. And at least view the depths. View the heights. Perceive yourself soaring and flying. Monetarily, spiritually, mentally, domestically, maritally, business-wise. Whatever the professional career is, soar like an eagle. Make that transition. Make that transaction. Make that transformation. Be the change you want to see in the world. Love you.